leave the word to you, right? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cenk. And
thank you so much for... Is this working?
Yeah.
Good. And thank you so much for inviting us. It's really nice to be in Izmir. We've been here for almost a week now, so we're starting to get to know the city a little. We want to know more, but unfortunately we're going home tomorrow. I think this is the first time we are doing a sitting presentation. We thought since the chairs were here, we're going to try it. So I hope that works out. Yes, like Cenk said, my name is Christian Strömqvist. I am a child culture designer, but we will talk a little more about what that is, from based in Gothenburg in Sweden. And together with Pontus, I also work as a teacher at or a lecturer at the Academy of Craft and Design at the University of Gothenburg. And then we have this project as well that we're going to talk about today here.
Yes.
Is this working as well? Is it fine? Yeah, and my name is Pontus, and I'm also a child culture designer. Actually, the presentation Christian had is very much working for me as well. I'm working as a lecturer at Academy of Design and Craft. I'm running this organization, and I also have my small business design work on the side. Yeah, but we start to talk about this, the reason why we're here. Play Without Borders. The logo symbol is a symbol of our planet and all the borders squeezed together into a small ball. It's ready for someone to start to play with. That's how we look upon our work. But for me it's also a symbol of an orange, which is the story that I sometimes use when I want to explain what we are doing. I worked with street children in Nicaragua many years ago, and we every Saturday we went to a field to play football. But we didn't have a football, but we had an orange tree, so we played with oranges and stuff. And it worked for 10 minutes and then they cracked, and then you had to run to the orange tree and pick a stick and try to get a new one. And that was as fun as playing with the football. And I think that in a way sums up what we want to do. We want to work and play, and we want to do it in a... We're not making fancy playgrounds. We want to do it... yeah, we want it to be on the... No, it should be easy to play, and it should be easy for the villages and the cities that we work inside to continue our work. And we don't want to be fancy or to make expensive, costly playgrounds. But we will explain this a bit more later. This is our crew. We are five people. It's Maria, Kalle, Christian, Christine, and me. And we are all former students from the same university. Unfortunately, it was just the two of us that could come this time. But yeah, this is the crew of our small organization. And this is what our organization is about. And I will read directly from the screen. What do we want? Play Without Borders wants to provide play opportunities for children and young people living in areas where play, for different reasons, not is prioritized. We believe that play is not just fun, it is also something serious. Play Without Borders states that play for children is at least as important as work for adults, but usually more fun than work for adults. How we want to do it? We want to provide play based on site-specific research and in close relation to the users, the children, most of the times. Children's perspective and involvement is the key for us to be able to do good projects. We want to make use of local labor and local materials. We want that the money that we invest stays within the community where we are active. So this is the main focus for our work. There is a lot of other things connected to this, of course. But I will take it from the beginning, where it all started once. HBK, that's the name of our university, University of Gothenburg, and Academy of Design and Craft. It changed the name newly, that's why we are a bit there. It was school before, but now it's academy. And especially then the graduate program called Shared Culture Design, which is the program that we both studied at a couple of years ago. And that's also the program where we now are teaching. And this is the building where we spend our days. It's in Gothenburg. I don't think you said that. In the central part of Gothenburg. It's an old building from 1902 or 1907. But the school started already in, yeah, it's like 160 years ago, so it's like an old education with a lot of history. And this is some examples of projects that have been done at this education during the years. It started in 2009, so it's quite a new education, this Child Culture Design graduate program. And it's quite small, it's around 12 students each year that get accepted, and it's very international, students from most parts of the world, South America, Asia, Europe, Australia sometimes maybe. Yeah, HUK is university with educations in design and craft, and also you can study there to become an art teacher. And the design department is what we call post-disciplinary, so we don't study product design or interior architecture or graphic design. We put all the students together in one class, and then they shape their education very much themselves by different choices during their years at the school, so they can choose some of the courses, and they can also choose tutors and so on. And I would say that social commitment is a very important thing at this school, but also collaborations, and it has a base, artistic base, but it's also very much craft oriented. We work a lot in our workshops, and students tend to produce their projects or artifacts or whatever they're doing themselves. And the Child Culture Design education is focused very much on play and on children's perspective, and we try to involve children in our projects. So we design for children and with children, and we make it differ. We differ children's. For us, it's a difference between children's perspective and child perspective. Children's perspective is their own perspective, and child perspective is our, the adult's perspective on how we think the children want it, what they need. But we always try to, as much as it is possible, to see things from their view. It's hard, but it's, you can get close if you're trying. Do you want to add anything to this?
No, I think that's just also then the foundation for how we work when we work with these projects that we're going to talk about today here as well. That this difference between children's culture or child culture, or the perspective as well, is through workshops and other ways of interacting or co-designing with children. That's how we try to find out these things that we cannot guess, that only they know and that only they can visualize. By doing different things, we find out sometimes as inspiration for what we do, but also sometimes as actual, to know what they want or how they want to play in a place or what you can do there. So we have that as a method. So a lot of these things that started from this education is also knowledge that we bring into our own work now, both in this collaboration and also in other projects that we work with outside outside this Play Without Borders thing.
And we also make a difference between both at the education and also in our work, places for children and children's places. And I think that's very important in what we are doing. Places for children is the ones that we construct for them and tell them to play. And children's places is the one that they invent themselves. And I think to be able to do good projects, it's crucial that we actually try to spot this. Places that they construct themselves.
And I think there is, from the Child Culture Design Program, like we were among the first to graduate it. Now there is, I don't know exactly, there has to be around 70 designers that have this title or a Master of Fine Arts in Child Culture Design. So slowly they're taking over the world, but spreading this kind of perspective as well into different kind of professions. So that is interesting, and it's just starting to form what kind of work you can do as a child culture designer. So I guess what we're going to talk is one example of how you can work that is more maybe socially engaged, and one way to work with children in a way that we think is really important. And I think that collaboration then, you saw our faces here before, that started actually back in 2009 then in an independent course at H2K that was about fair trade and fair trade design that went on for 1 year almost. And in the end of that course, we went away on a trip or a project in Thailand, north of Thailand in Chiang Mai, to work with Chiang Mai in Thailand, to work with the local artisans there and a company called Jedi Creation, like in Star Wars, but they it was from there, but I don't know if they had anything to do with it. But they were working with fair trade design in these like small villages outside Chiang Mai to give fair wages to craftsmen. But they were, these craftsmen were doing mostly umbrellas. They were working with bamboo umbrellas or bamboo, and also some local paper that they did there as well. So what we did there was to, in a way, see how if we could help developing their range with our perspective, and also but mostly to collaborate to find out new products to show that, yeah, this is possible to do with the same means, and maybe we could bring something. And then we worked a lot with these, worked with toys as an example. We were only there for 1 week, so that was a really short project, but they showed us how they were working, and together then we started coming up with different designs together that we can do, and that should be introduced into this company's range later on then. So that was actually how that trip was, how they started. So that was quite a long time ago. Then we didn't do anything together really. We were friends, so it was only 7 students then. But we stayed kept in touch, and then it was like 2014, 2 years ago, that we wanted to follow up on this project. Now that we all had graduated, we were not students anymore, so we wanted to see what happened, if we could do something more, revisit it. And it was then, they had shut down already, unfortunately, but then we decided that we wanted to continue this kind of work that we were doing. So we just wanted to use this knowledge that we have now from working with children a lot in a more global context and see how we could work with the child perspective and provide these play opportunities in places where there is none, really. So that's how this new project, Play Without Borders, that's how that started. So it all started in Thailand, but we're hoping also to be able to go back there and see what happened. But this is some examples of that course. It was from a student perspective. We did some bamboo toys. There were some tents in this paper fabric. This, I don't know what it's called in English, but that kind of toy that you can see there. Some small shovels and buckets for children that they could produce in the same way as they were producing the regular stuff. But it was also as a good example of just how you can bring in another perspective in this global context and work together.
And it was really interesting to come as a student from a Swedish university with all these machines that we were used to and work in these environments where they had one hand drill and one saw and that's it. But it was, yeah, this was the result. Yes, and then, as Christian said, we started in 2014, and we started really without a plan. We just had a will to work on in this field, but we didn't have a project or anything to start with. But by chance, very very luckily, we got an email 2 weeks later after we started. I think this was in February, from an organization called Kids of Uganda. And this is a Swedish organization based in Sweden, but they run an orphanage in a small village in the east part of Uganda, the rural part of Uganda. It started, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago. It was some kind of exchange program between the school in Sweden and the school in Uganda. And these people who started this organization wanted to continue their work in this village, so they started Kids of Uganda, and they now run one orphanage, a very small one. It's a small village. I don't know the number of inhabitants, maybe 1,000 or so, 2,000 maybe. And so they run an orphanage with around 10 children, and they also have some kind of support program where they give economical support to families in the area, the poorest families, and they make drill wells for water. So they have it close by where they live. I think they had made, today they made two dwells in this village. So they make a lot of good things, and their money is coming mainly from like Swedish family that sponsored them, or Swedish people, Swedes, that just want to send them some money. So they have a really tight budget, but they do a lot of good things. But when they contacted us, they had an idea about constructing a playground for the kids in the village. But they didn't really know how to do it, and they found us and they contacted us with this question: could you help us with designing a playground? And for us, that was perfect start for this for our work. We had an organization that we could collaborate with, which was what we were in need of at this time. But their question was if we could design a playground and then send them the blueprints, more or less, but we wanted to do it in a more durable way. So we said if we're going to do this, we need to go to Uganda, because we don't know anything about Uganda. We knew about Idi Amin, and that was the only thing we knew, more or less, and that didn't really help us in this situation. So we said we need to go there, we need to get to know the children, and we need to get to know Uganda and this place, Bobolo. So me and Christian went down in August of 2014. Maybe I should change to a more interesting thing. And we met these kids. It was the first time for both of us in Africa, and we came to this village late at night. It was pitch dark. It was dogs barking, and we could hear some music from the local party, and it was motorbikes driving next to us, and it was the smell of barbecue, and we couldn't see anything. We didn't know if we were in the right part of Uganda. And we knew we were going to stay in some kind of hostel or guest house. But we managed to get there. And we were in the right village, luckily. And then the next morning we met these guys who are living in this orphanage. And then we were, I think we were 2 weeks in Uganda. And we didn't want to tell the children why we were there, because when it comes to these kinds of projects, things can change, and we weren't sure if the playground actually would be constructed. So we just tried to socialize with the children and spend time with them and to see how they are living their lives and what they are doing and where they are playing and who is playing and when are they playing and what do they already have in the village. So we just spent our days with them and we did what they were doing. And they showed us the area. So this is, I think that is from the first day when they took us on a long walk around the surroundings of the village. A really beautiful place. Yeah, and then we just, when they went to collect water, we went with them to see how it worked. And they start to, most people in this village are farmers. They have their own piece of land. And the children start to work in these farmland when they are really young. So if they're not in school, they are working. So they are playing while working. Another very important thing was to meet the right people and get connections and shake a lot of hands with the local authorities. And it is a lot of politics involved in this project that we don't understand really. But we met a lot of people, local policemen, and the lady in the middle is the one who runs the orphanage in place in Uganda. She's an amazing person. We also went around to meet local craftsmen to see what kind of material do they have, what do they produce themselves, what can we use to build a playground. Because as we said before, we want the money that we invest that they stay in the village or in the area, and we want them to be able to repair the playground if something happens, and we also want them to inspire neighboring villages to be able to do the same thing. If they have a nice playground here that the kids like, why can't they do it in the neighbor village if it's just things that we already have in the area. And since we couldn't say to the kids that we were here to do research for playground, we had to find other ways to discuss these matters with them. So we did some small workshops with clay, for example, where we made small playgrounds and we tried to figure out anyway without really asking the question. The first thing they made was a cell phone. Yeah, we saw kids playing with these their homemade toys, for example. And then we went home with a lot of new experience and we started to do some sketches. Now we knew where in the village it was supposed to be, we knew the surroundings, we knew how they play a little bit, and we knew where they went to school and so on. So it was much easier for us now to start this work. This is some of the sketches inspired by the how they build their houses and how they paint the houses. Also inspired by the big sugarcane field that they had in the village.
I can just jump, I'm sorry,
yeah,
interrupting.
Yeah.
No, but it's also this, when talking to children and when working in workshopping together with children, it is when designing something that's not supposed to be just a plastic playground if you don't want to put something there, but add something more and to get closer to this, we call them the children's culture or something. It's important to to kind of ask the right questions. And here we were not talking about a playground, but that's also something when you work otherwise, to not ask, okay, we're going to build a playground in this area, what do you want there? A lot of people think that is how you co-design with children, like, okay, what do you want? Then we want a swing, because that is what I know. But yeah, don't you want something more? Yeah, I want 1,000 swings. That's perfect, because in a way, if you don't provide them with tools to talk about it, then it's like, yeah, this is what I've seen, so this is what I want to have here. But then it's more to ask other questions, like, okay, what can you do in this place? Who could live here? What do you usually play here? If you went here with your sister, what would you play then? And then to work with these clues for us to come into a place like this, you don't know that much about the culture, only what you can see. But then by doing this, you find out clues about, okay, this is how they live, and this is, and it opens up doors to imagination as well. But then, what's the inspiration to what we did here?
Yeah, I was saying, in general, when you ask children a question, they answer according to what they think you want to hear, because they want to say the right thing. And if you ask them about a playground, they will ask according to what they already know, of course. And if you are from a small village in Uganda, you don't know much more than a swing and a slide. Yes, and then I think it took more than 1 year before they actually started to construct this village, playground. And we used their locally produced bricks, and we used wood from the surrounding forests, and we used old car tires. And it was a long process. It was a process to find the right spot in the village, because the mayor, for example, he wanted the playground to be closer to his house, because that was better for him. And this organization, Kids of Uganda, wanted to be in another spot. So it was a long process. And then they calculated on the material they needed, and they sent it to us, and we calculated as well, and we got a totally other sum. For example, the bricks that they needed was 4 times as much as we thought they were needing. And we said to them, like, do you understand the scale of the playground? Like, this is for children. And they said, yeah, we understand, totally. And then they started to build it, and they didn't understand the scale, really. But you will see later, it's a huge playground. And the house that was supposed to be for children is now a full-scale house. But it will be something else, and it will still be fun. I think this was 1 year ago, and then things happened, and we had to do some changes in our sketches because of termites, for example. They started to eat the tree, things that we don't really have to care about in Sweden. But then finally they started again to work on this, and I think it was a month ago, and now just earlier this week we got these pictures that I will come to soon. This was they really wanted to perform. They talked a lot about dancing and singing, and they wanted a place where they could show their friends and families what they were doing. So this was the base of some kind of performing stage. And it was supposed to be 2 meters in diameter. I think it's 6 meters, but it's fine. And this photo came like 3 days ago, I think, so now they actually start to, yeah, it's a playground, and it looks fun, and I think it will be great for the kids. And we will, maybe we'll talk about it later, but we will go back in August again this year to continue this and to do some add-ons to the existing playground, the whole group of us, all 5. So, yeah, 2 years after we started, it will be really finished.
Yeah, I can take that one. So that was the first project, and that last year it was not finished, as we said, but we still learned a lot about how to work in a different context, really. And that took us later to Nairobi. We got in contact with another organization that's called Hope Raisers through Architects Without Borders in Sweden. And Hope Raisers is an organization that is based in Korogocho slum area. This is a really bad picture, but it shows this slum area in Nairobi that is about 1 or 1.5 square kilometers, where it lives 100,000 people. It's a little, some say 80,000, some say 150,000 people, but it's a lot of people living in a really, really dense area, a really small one. And 70% of the people that are living there are under 30 years old. And this name, Korogocho, it's Swahili and it means crowded, shoulder to shoulder. So it's really crowded. There's people from 30 different ethnical groups that live in this place, and there's a lot of problems that comes with this. That is violence, prostitution, criminality, drug use, and of course there's no health care. And in this problem, in this area, there is some people that want to like work with the youth and try to see, to show all the good things that actually exist in this area. So there's one guy, and that's what this organization Hope Raisers is doing. So last year in August as well, 2015, they organized a festival that was called 7 Days of Street Democracy, where they work with different things concerning democracy. So there's everything from street art to, they had a music festival as well and different speaks and initiatives. So this guy Daniel that we met, he's like the jenk of Korogocho, but he's the spider in the web organizing and getting people together. So this place that we went to, it really seems like it's a place that's not really, it's very unsuited for children, and it really is that as well. There is, but there's still so many children that live around here in this place with all the garbage, and they live there every day. And they're playing, and there's motorcycles driving by, and but of course they are still playing. So we wanted to know a little also about what their life is, and how do they perceive their situation. Where do they play and how do they play, and how they look upon themselves as playing people. So yeah, in August we went down there, the whole group of us, all five, and so we got on an airplane and went to Nairobi. And it was really, yeah, now we had been to Uganda, it's two completely different countries and completely different situations, but it's still, it's a lot of impressions that you get when you get to this place. But what we wanted to do is, of course, to find out how they play. So we started interacting with the kids. We were, as a part of that program as well, we were going to do some play activities or create some kind of play structures at a schoolyard within Korogocho. And it was a place that was not, like, quite unsafe. They took us through this main street in, on motorcycles quite fast, but after a while when you were there you start to get to know people. Of course it's always not as dangerous as it is communicated before. But we met these kids that were amazing as well and that spent time on this schoolyard. So we were gonna work with I think something like 30 kids that were there, and they were gonna help us. So the first day when we started working, we did some workshops together with them as well. They took us around, they showed how they were playing, some conventional, you know, they play football of course, like you do everywhere, and basketball, but also some local games, showing us the place. And these kids at the schoolyard, the more time we were there, there was just more and more kids coming. One day there was about 100 children helping us building this playground, so they were everywhere. But yeah, it was quite an impression and quite an experience to work with them.
And our job changed that day from building playgrounds to be the ones who were supposed to find brushes for all the kids who wanted to paint. When we asked them it was like a bunch of kids around us, and we asked, does anyone want to help us to paint? And they all raised their hands. And I asked, like, oh, nice that they are so enthusiastic. And Daniel said, like, the guy who Christian talked about, said, yeah, of course, they had never seen paint before. It's the first time that they ever get the chance to paint anything. So, of course, they were enthusiastic.
And the difference, I guess, with this project was that then we were really working together with the kids as well. The first day, yeah, we played pretty much to get to know what they're doing, and then we started building things. The same thing here, we were going to use local resources, local things. We had some ideas in advance that we were going to work from, which was car tires. That is a common thing because they use them and they wear them down. There was some wood and stuff like that we could work with. So we had all these people and organizations that we worked with that helped us build as well. So some things move slower because of that, and some things move faster as well. Here's one picture of the car room. But we focused on, it was not that important that these structures were going to stand there forever and these things were going to be there forever. It was more the interaction of doing it, again, in such a simple way that it can be imitated. It was also important to get to know the people there so that they, so it's not stolen or taken away right away. It has to come from start within the community, so it can stay there. And things like, this tire dome that we built was, when we planned it, if you're going to build a dome with tires, it should be tires that are two sizes and hopefully the same size. That was not the case. We got tires in all different sizes that we could buy there. They were also really, really soft, so that structure is supposed to hold. This structure was a very soft structure, but it's still holding, and apparently it's still there today. So we did this dome. We also did this tire bridge in a way that you can jump on, sit on. They were also using it to sleep in. This, here we worked with, what's it called, pallets, wood pallets, that we could get hold of as well, because they had a big football court, but they didn't have any, what's it called, where you sit and watch football as well. So we did this combination of a stage and audience place that worked really well, that we all painted together as well. We also focused on this, what kind of games do you play and how do you play them, and again with the paint that was really easy, accessible and effectful. We used painted this basketball court that they had, where it was a big asphalt ground pretty much, and just added lots and lots of paint and created game areas where they could play as well. So that was, the project. It was just, how long were we there? 4 days or something. But it made so much, there was a lot of things happening. And I think the most important, the most important thing of this is, of course, the play opportunities that arise, but it's also the collaborations that we make. One big group or a big part of this was an organization called Slum Architects, that is a student-based organization in Nairobi, that also engage in similar projects in the slum, but they don't really go out there, or the most people that are involved in this organization, they have actually never been to the slum, as it's common, of course, in big cities that you don't go to those areas. And they've identified the problems, and they see all these organizations like us coming from abroad to do something in their country, and they're like, we have the competence, so why can't we do anything ourselves, which they can. But it was a great, we collaborated with them, so they were there helping as well and translating and building together with us. So the biggest win in this is the collaborations you make, and just like you said with Uganda, they're going to have this festival this year again, so we're going to go back and do some kind of follow-up on this, see how much is broken and how much is still standing, and continue to work with it.
I think as well as it did it as well, just because we went to Korogocho and we went out of the cars and we worked there. There is a lot of NGOs and UN are active in this area, but when they are there, they are coming in black jeeps and they have guards and they stay for 5 minutes and then they leave and they go to their office with air conditioning. But we went there and we made it together with them, and I think that was a big deal as well. And when we came the first day, we met this guard that opens the gates when you come to the school. He was called Soldier. We asked why. It's more, Soldier is like a respectful name, so they wanted him to be called that. And he was a really thin guy, and he wasn't really happy about us being there. You could see in his eyes, he was giving us his bad eye. And he wasn't really helpful in the beginning. But then after a couple of days, he became more and more soft. And then at the end, he was one of the most enthusiastic builders of the playground. I think that was a good sum up of the project and what happened.
Yeah, because what we're doing, of course, we're creating play opportunities. We have fun, which is a big part of it. The kids have fun as well. But what we want to do is also to declare that play is important. We think it's important, and they get to know it's important. And after being there, they also have this idea that yeah, it could actually be something. It's something that brings people together. It's important for the kids, not only in a school situation, but in all situations. And they're also having a lot of fun, both parents and children, helping out together. Yeah. Do you want to add something there?
No, I could add, this is also area, this school is in the area between two different slum areas, Babadogo. And they have different political views. It's very, lots of tensions in this area. So I think that's also the reason why it's very important to bring people together like this, in this area.
Yes.
Yes.
And from Gothenburg to Thailand to Uganda and Kenya, we now came to Izmir. We were invited to do this talk today, but also to have a workshop in Basmane, the historical peninsula. And we've been collaborating with Izmir Tari Tasarim, that's correct. Yeah. For 2 days, Thursday and Friday this week. And yeah, this is very new for us. We haven't really discussed what really happened. So, but we will try to take you through these days as well. We came there on Wednesday first, just to see the area and to meet some people and to see the place where we were supposed to work, and also to go around and give out some flyers. And then on Thursday, the workshop started. And we had no clue if it's going to be one kid or 30 kids. And no one really knew. So our plans was a bit loose because we didn't really know how to tackle the situation. But we ended up with a group of 6 kids, which was really nice, and they were 4 of them were from Syria, and we had 2 from Kazakhstan as well. And since Tari Tasarim, one of their missions is to bound the people living in this area and connect them to the history of Izmir, but also to improve the lives of the people living here by design thinking and by some small interventions in the area. So of course it's very focused on this area and on the city and the city life, so we thought it was a good idea to work with the city as a subject for this. And we couldn't do anything really big in 2 days, so we decided to just work in like models, scale, small scale models. And we gave them the task to build a city and try to bring their ideas about what a city could be and should be if they were the one who decided. So it was very much about letting their voices be heard and to give them the chance to actually decide something, even though it's just a model city or a cardboard city. So we started from scratch, and the first question was, what is the most important thing in the city? And we got lots of answers, and then we started to build and started to... We used, as we always do, very cheap materials like cardboard and paint and some barbecue sticks and more or less tape. And it was a mixture between having fun painting, building and discussing at the same time. So we were sitting around this table that we covered in cardboard, and then we constructed this city. And the city consisted of schools, hospitals, offices, houses, some playgrounds. It was very, what we already have today, was very like a normal city. And we tried to make them think of other things that maybe not exist today, but it's in a city, but that they really would like to have. But it was kind of hard, and 2 days is maybe, maybe we needed 1 week to be able to really come deep in these issues. But we ended up with a river of chocolate as well, and a rainbow of flowers.
And I guess this is, I mean, it's about methodology. Like now for us, when coming here, you hear a lot in Sweden, now with the current, we talked about it before, but the crisis, or there's a lot of people moving with refugees coming to Sweden as well, and here is one part where you move through as well, and you hear a lot, but you don't know. So for us, it's important to get to come here as well, or many other places, and just get to know the children. And I think if we're gonna be here longer, like you said, to actually create some more play opportunities, this is a very small play opportunity. So it's more about that playful situation, but in the same time, we learn a lot about how they perceive this area, how they perceive the situation. And just by working with cardboard and paint, you can really get a lot out of it if you have the time. If we would have more time, then you could start working with this as a model to looking at other possibilities. Okay, what will happen here in between the houses? How would you play? What would be possible? To let them go around more, showing us the area as well, and then start working more hands-on. But this, now it's more of a chance to get to know the kids here in İzmir, in Basmane, and to have fun as well, which is a play opportunity in itself.
Yeah, to have fun is something that you have to take seriously, I think, because if you don't have fun, they will lose their interest quite fast. So it has to be a good mixture between seriousness and fun.
There's a lot of design going on.
Yeah, and we see this as a start of something else, of something bigger, and we would like to come back and work more with this area and these children.
We had a lot of help with Jamsu that was in the picture there.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a good thing she's not here. I don't know if she would have liked that picture. But because of course language is also something. We come here, they don't speak English that much, of course, which is also the fact in these all the places we've gone through, that there is very basic English or no English. And then if you're not going to have a crash course in language a long time before, it's hard to communicate. But of course, with paint and color and stuff, that's one way to communicate. But it's also really important with these collaborations to have work with people that have started something and just take that work further by coming together. And that also can translate what we're saying, and so to get an understanding.
And now we have six ambassadors of Play Without Borders running around in Basmane. That's really nice.
So there was a lot of fun, and one of the best ways to get to know a city as well. Should I take the small remote? Yeah, we didn't really have a name for this, but it's just who we are and what we do and where we want to go with this as well, because what we're working with is play, and we don't really have any other agenda than that or any other purpose. Play, importance of play, and the right to play is important enough for us. But like a positive side effect is that hopefully this work that we do can inspire others to work in a similar way and do other things. To inspire the children, the local organizations, and also other people at the places where we are. And also by working, like you said before, with local material and local resources, we try to make sure that the money that we have to invest also stays within that community. But we don't really see ourselves as a charity organization. It's more as an organization, we don't have any goals that are connected to economic growth in any way or that kind of stuff. But what we want to do is to create other values than economic through co-creation and participation as well. And the value system, the values within these play opportunities that we want to create, and in the collaborations and the connections that we make when we work like this. Because we're quite aware that we can't just show up in any place and say that we should build a playground here, because there is a lot of needs, there is a lot of politics, and a lot of people saying that, yeah, but we have much more important issues than play to work with. But we think that play is important enough, and that's what we want to work with. But to just do that, to show up like that, can be misunderstood and send the wrong signals, of course. So that's why collaboration is important. And through that, then we learn the specific context of the places that we're visiting and work in a way that is suitable for that context. So it's about this knowledge of exchange and skills that we learn a lot from the people we visit, but hopefully they also get something from us as well. And just again to highlight, it's not really here, but this organization Slum Architects that we talked about in Kenya, that we're gonna continue to collaborate with now as well, that through this collaboration they also found one way that they could work, and of course we couldn't have done what we did without them as well. So that's important, and also to introduce these thoughts of play. We are a small child culture design education that of course we think is really important, but we also have to, the students have to communicate that, and we have to communicate why it is important and how play can be a tool within design and architecture, but also in all other disciplines as well. So it's important for us to be humble when we work, to take the time to talk, to go to a place and maybe be there and just play with people for a long time to create some kind of mutual respect and understanding and lasting connections. And we're not only working then with design as construction. It's one of the most important things for us is also to map out play in a global context, to really try to understand how to create this base of knowledge, like how do people play, how do children play in different contexts. It's a more global world now, so we can hopefully use that knowledge in a way both when we're working and also to transfer to other people that we're working with and students as well. We're very new as an organization and we're still learning and trying to figure out how do we want to work in the future. And even if these projects and why we're here as well have been executed abroad in other contexts, we also have a lot of issues in Sweden that we want to work with that we haven't done so much now except in our own profession. So that is one way that we're gonna take this work, hopefully. But then it's also good to know how play work in a more global and bigger context. We talk about places where play is not prioritized, and of course play is not really prioritized in Sweden as well. There is some great playgrounds and some forest where you can play and stuff like that, but it's not always that looked up on as something really, really important. And yeah, this summer we're going to go back to both Bubolo and to Korogocho as well. We'll see when we can come back to Izmir and do something more. But it's also important this with the exchange. We had people from Kenya also visiting us in Gothenburg, so to not just go there one time and then say bye-bye, I hope you had fun, but to actually continue to follow up and to organize events that happens, yeah, that continues. And one of the biggest issues for us is because we, yeah, it's a non-profit organization, so it's time is a problem, because we have to work as well. So that's one thing that we're struggling with. But we're also now as working at the university and as teachers that we can take this project and somehow include that in the curriculum, create an independent course or include it in the program somehow, to be able to use students and also parts of these collaboration and the networks that we are within to continue to develop these methods and do similar projects where we can tutor or be a part of it and help out in some way. But yeah, we're, even though, yeah, time is a challenge, so but we're not rushing. It's not like people will stop to play and it's, things will have to take its time. So we're just hoping that by taking its time and evaluating our methods, evaluating everything from these small workshops to the stuff we're doing, we can become better at what we do and continue to do more important projects. Because I think inspiration and introducing this perspective is something that in the long run could make a difference as well. And while we're doing it, we're also having a lot of fun, and hopefully the people that we work with. Yeah, I don't know if I have anything more. Do you have something to add?
Maybe. No, but I guess we should leave some time if there is any questions. Maybe.
Yes.
Of course.
So you travel to the few countries such as Thailand, Uganda, Nairobi, and Turkey. So my question is that how different were the children in these different countries? How different was their needs and their wants? And if yes, in which way?
There's a lot of things that are similar. Now I just took it. Kids are kids, and I think all the stuff that makes the world complicated happens later on when you become bigger. So there are some things that you can see right away that unites people. Football, for instance, that's always the first thing. If you want to get to know children, that's how we have done in all this. Actually, not here now, but that was really short of time. They wanted to, I think. But you play football. It's something that everyone unites. But of course, play is something universal. Then there's different levels, which also depends on what kind of toy and play opportunities I think that is introduced. When you have to start working, I mean, in Sweden you don't start working until you're 18, pretty much. And that's how privileged we are in a way. But like in Bubolo, these kids start working from when they're really 5-6 years old, which also affects how and when they can play, I think. So, but of course they are similar in a way, but it's the context, depending on how that is. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think to get to know, if we're talking about playgrounds or what kind of play opportunities that can be done, for us it is important because the context is different, of course, like what kind of, just to create these familiarities, like in that playground with the river we made and the stage and something like that. That is something very local, and also what kind of material do they have right there? Okay, here we worked with bricks, here there's some tires, here it might be something else. So those things are important for us.
I think one interesting thing that we found out when we came to Bobola in Uganda, for example, is that one of the kids staying all the kids staying in the orphanage, if you compare to Swedes, the Swedish kids in the same age, they're very mature because they need to be, because they need to work earlier, need to start to work, and they need to bring money to the family. But at the same time, you could see kids of like 15, 16 years that were doing the same thing as kids of that maybe are 8 years in Sweden, because they didn't have the chance to play when they were eight. So they still think it's fun to go and slide when they're 15. So I think the environment and the situation of life changes the needs of the children very much.
Yeah, and that is really something. I mean, when you are working in your profession, for instance, and you're going to design something, and also in a way in the education that we're a part of now, then you talk about like, okay, the kids in this age is like this, then the kids in this age are like that, but that's not always true. It feels like it's really context based like that. So, and that's something that we have learned, I guess, by just doing these things as well.
And also in Sweden, in our context, children often play with other children in the same age. If you're in a small village, they play with the kids that are around. It doesn't matter if they are 8 or 16 or 10 or 2. And in Kolgotsjo, they have to take care about their small sisters and brothers also when they are playing. So in these countries, on these places, they care much more in bigger groups, and they don't really care about the age gap that we do that much in our society. And that's also something that you need to take and deal with. You need to make a playground, because you know there will be children from 2 to 8 who may be the same age.
Any other question?
Well, thank you. First of all, I don't know if this is a question that is suitable or not. You mentioned that you are not a charity organization. My questions might be pushing towards that, so you can stop me at any point. But you're non-profit at the same time, so the boundary is a bit blurry in that sense. I have two questions in a way. The first one, especially from the Thailand work, the toys were so cute. I mean, I know you are designing them with the kids, so there is a copyright issue, but did you ever consider having a line of sustainable, simple children's toys to support what you are doing? That's the first question, because I think that will be great seeing some of the examples. The second one is more regarding the refugee camps, because you are talking about places where the play is not priority, and refugee camps is a reality today, and not necessarily Syrian condition. In Africa for years, we have refugee camps in different parts of the world as well. And I was thinking, did you at any point consider contacting UNICEF or United Nations to do something there? Because they can do much better instead of taking Angelina Jolie to the refugee camps, taking you guys, and see how the foundation of the refugee camp includes some play for children as well. So, thank you.
Thank you. To answer the first question, we have thought about many different ways to make this to an economical, sustainable organization. Now we're basing all the projects we do on scholarships, and that takes quite some time, because it's usually quite small amounts of money, and you get money for one project at a time, then you have to start to look for more money, which makes it hard to plan for the future. We have discussed different plans or different ideas, and one idea that we discussed was to actually build playgrounds in Sweden as that you actually pay for, and then when you pay for your playground in Sweden, you also pay for a playground somewhere else. That could be one idea. We haven't really talked about making toys or a line of toys. It could be a possibility as well. I know this was made of bamboo, and bamboo is really hard to work with in Sweden because it will crack quite soon. But of course, that could be a possibility. Yeah, we would like to
develop
and find a way to make this more long-term sustainable. But we are quite new, and this is the fourth project we do, and we're still trying to find our way and trying to guide ourselves in this world.
Which is also, in a way, the answer to the second question as well, that we haven't talked about that, and we would really, of course, like to go. But it's also been this time issue to what is possible, and time is, it's something you fight against a little. So. And it's also, I mean, this is, I think that's when you said not a charity organization, that can be really discussed, that concept, what is charity, and I think it depends on how we do it. I think we still see this as a design project, in a way. That is something that we're doing for ourselves and for the others at the same time, but it has this, how do you say, egoistic is the wrong word, but we benefit from it as well, in a way, so that's why we don't really see it as that. But of course it would be great, and we've talked about there is this, yeah, but as a design project, when we have this, which we have discussed as well, the Without Borders name, I think we talked about it before, then that also, then you start thinking about these huge organizations like Medicine Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, and Architects Without Borders, perhaps, or Clowns Without Borders, and I know they are doing these great things in the camps as well. So we talked about how can we collaborate there, we just haven't been there yet, or gotten that far.
I think one thing also has been that we haven't really got so many projects, so we didn't feel that we could go directly to the big elephants, maybe. We needed to, I don't know, it doesn't feel right to say portfolio, but it's some kind of portfolio to show us, to show the one we contact what we actually can do. But now we start to get some amount of projects, so maybe the next step will be to start contacting organizations. But it's also kind of nice to be a small organization and to be able to actually take your own decisions, and it doesn't always have to be better to be big. I think then we need to be, for some organizations it might be good to be small as well, because you need to have the lust, and the, it has to be fun also for us to be, to make it possible for us to continue to work, because we don't earn money from this, we have to work as well, so if it's not fun, then we will lose it, and then the organization will probably disappear. So we have to find a way that is like suitable and makeable for us to run.